Welcome and thank you so much for joining us for this Q&A discussion of the world premiere of the documentary feature film Chocolate Road by Tanya Chudorkova. My name is Samantha Ryan and I'm part of the programming team here at Greenwich International Film Festival. I am also the office manager. Joining us today from GIF, we also have co-founder and director of programming Colleen Devere. Colleen, you can be.
Hi.
And we are also joined by our executive director, Ginger Stickle.
Hello and welcome everyone.
So it is such a tremendous honor for us as a film festival with a social impact mission to be able to host the world premiere of a film like Chocolate Road, which really, you know, while it's delightful and delicious, it also touches on deeper messages of, you know, farming sustainability and, you know, the environment, all of which we hope to explore in our panel today. So without further ado, I would like to introduce this amazing creative team behind the delicious Chocolate Road. Tanya Chudorkova, I hope I'm saying your last name correctly.
Please. Good enough.
Close enough. That's okay. I get a pass. Thank you. So Tanya is the writer, director, and co-producer of the film. And we also have Kim E. Wang joining us, who is a co-producer and cinematographer. And for those of us who have seen the film already, it's such a treat to be able to see our chocolatiers, Maribel Lieberman joining us from New York, and Mikael Friesholm joining us from Denmark today. So this panel really puts the international in Greenwich International Film Festival this time around. So welcome everyone. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. So I thought we could kick off the panel by talking about inspiration. And I thought Tanya and Kim, you might be able to talk about, you know, what inspired this film? Where did the idea come from?
Yeah, great. So the idea of the film came kind of out of the blue for us. Japanese producer, actually, who was not able to make it, but this panel, but he is actually the creator of the idea. So he had, his name is Takayuki Yasuda. So he's the originator. He had a very kind of abstract idea. He loves chocolate. He loves everything food related. And he also really cares about sustainability and, you know, giving back, getting back to the roots, finding out where things come from. And so he wanted to do a film about chocolate and how chocolate, I guess, brings peace to people. But it was at the beginning of the inception was kind of very, this high idea that we had to go back down and like bring down to the ground and actually figure out how to make into a movie. And then we kind of very fast jumped into our first filming trip in Peru, following chocolatier Susumu Kuyama. And once we were there, we found our real inspiration, which was all the process, not just the chocolate making. First, it started as chocolate making, but we found out that not just the cooking part, or that actually there's so much more steps before that, and that a lot of people don't know about the whole process, and that's kind of the most interesting part was for all of us, that we were fascinated. Kim, maybe you can.
Yeah, basically that's what happened. Before it happened, Tanya got me involved in there. Before this happened, I just thought chocolate would get in the supermarket checkout counter and just popped it in, like that was, you know. But when I met Takayuki, you know, the first time being introduced, it came out with a box of chocolate from Susumu Kuyama. It was really fancy. It came with a booklet and instruction as number where you can eat it. It came with a little tiny knife and we get a glass of water, you know, to cleanse your palate. I was like, wow, this is different. It's like, then when I tasted it, I tried it, like it was a whole new experience for me. And I got more and more interested. And of course they did a lot. We did a lot of homework finding the best chocolatiers to go with. And we were lucky enough to meet these three people here. Chocolatiers, and we hit it off, and they had shared similar values with us. That each one wants to not just make great chocolate, also to give back to the community, sustainability, you know, environment. So we decided as we move along, start, like Tanya said, we just started, the story starts happening, and we got more and more focus to bring it into what, you know, actually is right now.
Yeah, we also found that all three of them, I mean, and as many chocolatiers you have, there's many different approaches to how you make the chocolate and what your process is. So it was very interesting for us to find that, they had a lot of things in common, but also a lot of different things. So going into that and like following each of their process was what really was the most inspiring and the most interesting for us. And the fact that they wanted to, each of them is interested in the beginning of their product, not just the final result that they're making, but like where it comes from, how is it made, who makes it, are they fairly compensated, are they fairly, you know, presented later when they're selling the product. So that was very interesting for us.
And for our chocolatiers, what do you love most about making chocolate? What inspires you, and what do you love about making chocolate?
I feel I got into chocolate 20 years ago. Before that, I was doing, I did a catering company. And before that, I started fashion. One of the things that really made me go into food was that, living in New York, I encounter a lot of different cultures. And it's amazing how everybody values their food, but other cultures don't know about it. And what inspired me to do into cooking is because I feel that we humans, we eat food all the time and we don't really pay attention where this come from, you know? It's just on the table and you eat it. Most of the people in the world think that chocolate the best chocolate comes from France or from Belgium or from Switzerland, and didn't know much of the story. So I wanted to give the story. So what made me go into chocolate. When I got into it, I got into deep and then started researching the recipes of the Aztecs, of the Mayans. And then I remember, you know, growing up, we had cacao in the countryside where I lived, but we used to call it cacao, and I had no idea that cacao was chocolate, you know? So anyway, for me, it's all these discoveries, I felt like I was destined to fall into this and really show the world that the chocolate is a gift comes from America and is a gift to the whole world. So when I put the designs on the chocolate, I don't want just people to eat it, but also stop, read a little bit where it comes from, enjoy visual, and then taste it, you know? And that to me that is a better experience than just putting something in your mouth and disappears.
And what about you, Miguel?
Well, chocolate for me, yeah, I'm a trained chef originally. Mm-hmm. So this is where it starts. And my chocolate story starts in the late 90s. Actually, by falling into a pot in San Francisco, literally, and since then it's been a quest to get to know about it. And what I found, what I met with Scharfenberger, was the first part of a story, which for me is very much a chef's story, in the sense that we could look at chocolate as any other high profile product, like wine or beer or coffee. It had all the potential for being this, but no one at all had explored that part of cacao and chocolate. Chocolate is a difficult business to go in. There's a saying that if you wanna end up with a small fortune making chocolate, you gotta start with a big fortune. So it's kind of it has to be a labor of love in a sense, because the big guys are so big. They make chocolate so cheap that actually going in and trying to change that narrative is really difficult. But it's fun.
And that actually takes us to another question that I had. So much of the film really is, you know, part of it is about you guys and part of it is about your relationship with the producers of the cacao. And, you know, it's such an important relationship. And I would love to hear, you know, you discuss that in a little bit more detail and why it is such an important relationship for the sustainability, not only of, you know, chocolate in general, but, you know, for chocolatiers and for the farmers. There's at some point in the film, someone says that everyone's moving, the children of the farmers are not staying. They're not taking over. You know, this is not an intergenerational industry, you know, the children are moving for the where the opportunity is. And that was heartbreaking for me.
It's a thing that happens in a lot of different work environments or countries or parts of the world. For my part, becoming a chef was totally different than following any normal middle-class kid aspiration, because in the early 90s, becoming a chef was definitely a blue-collar work and a step down the ladder. Instead of going to university and doing something with that, I definitely had the possibility of doing that, but I ended up becoming a chef instead. Finding myself in the middle of a new wave of star chefs and television chefs, and suddenly it also became a world. I just, you know, saw the old chef world, which was a blue-collar, hardworking thing that's definitely not something where you would want your kid to go into. And then it disappeared and became something much more interesting, where you could move on from being a chef, or you could be a creative chef. You couldn't do something, you would be admired for your creativity and all that stuff. And this thing is definitely not really existing at the farmer level at this point. So you need to have some sort of, we need to create, which is both Maribel and I and Susumu are creating, something where chocolate becomes more than just, you know, three colors.
I think it needs to move towards that direction, because it will continue if it is so industrial. It's going to continue like that. The farmers are going to suffer, just like they've been not getting the proper earnings for what they do. And I think this wave of people like Mikael and I and you know, and other chocolatiers, of really giving the value of the ingredient, where it comes from and who does it, what is the process, I think is a way to teach other generations, you know, to learn how to appreciate that. If they learn to appreciate it if they know the story. Because there's only so much we can do, small people like us. There's only so much. I mean, I'm doing my little part, but that's not enough, you know. I mean, I went back to Honduras and got in touch with women. You know, I had a foundation that helped me gather women farmers that are growing cacao. And I mean, a lot of these people didn't even know the taste of chocolate. You know, the only love that they have is like they can sell it. It's another like a bean, you know, or rice. But once you teach these people the taste, teach them how to ferment it or to dry it and to make a chocolate, then they also become more aware of the value of that, you know. So it needs to work on both ends.
That's an excellent, excellent point. So, Tanya, going into this project, how much did you know about chocolate production? Did you know all of this?
No, totally not. No. I mean, I had like a very vague idea, but I had no idea. Like, I actually didn't have any idea, because I was one of those people that would just grab something and not think about it, more eat it and that's it. And when we started all the research and when we went into our first trip in Peru, I was just, all of us, the whole team, the whole crew was just totally fascinated. When we actually saw the real cacao on the tree and all the work that it takes and all the people that are involved and like this whole other part of it, that's a lot longer than actually the final, like processing of everything. So it really blew my mind. It has totally changed my perception of how I eat chocolate, I think that applies to other things now, because I started to question other things that I took for granted and like other foods that I always eat that I never thought about. So it created this interest in me also to research a little more, like where does my pineapple comes from, or you know, it's what Maribel is saying, like the more you learn about it, the more interest you have and the more you value it. You create interest in the origin, and now you're not just buying a dark chocolate, you're buying a chocolate from Peru, from Uganda, from somewhere, you know.
Tanya, I could say one thing. When she started, she didn't know about chocolate, but after we got into this project, she literally bought the whole of Amazon of every books out in chocolate. She researched everybody, called up all the, like, you know, she talked to scientists, genotherapists of chocolatiers, chocolate guru. So she had this bunch of notes like this that she went through and studied everything about chocolate, you know, in the white while we're going.
I mean, not everything. I cannot possibly know everything, but I researched a lot because it was just so interesting for me also. I mean, it just opened my mind to so many other things that now I want to read.
It's beautifully shot. It's absolutely gorgeous. Your appreciation for, you know, the beauty of chocolate still very much came across in how you shot it and how you shot like the cacao pods and the beans. And it was just, the film is getting so much love from our audience. Everyone is really responding so positively to it.
I have to say, we've had a lot of really good feedback on Chocolate Road. People were enticed to watch that film first because, number one, the title is like delicious, obviously. Number two, it's the world premiere. And it was very inviting for people to watch the film.
I'm happy to hear.
Were there any fun, like behind the scenes instances that you guys want to share with us or that you feel like you can share, like funny anecdotes or?
Well, I think mostly like for us, I think one of the places we went, I think it was in Nicaragua, was it? It was like a couple of hours, 5-6 hours or by plane and 5 hours or something on a speedboat. Yeah, and we had a speedboat and on a bus. And when we got there, we had to climb up a mountain with all the gear. And we forgot to bring water.
Yeah. I remember. Yeah, we were silly.
Oh my God, we went there and I was so excited. I was talking. I did realize halfway through I should just shut up and save my energy and climb up. But when I went there and met the farmer, they were so sweet. They came into this coconut water. It was the most delicious water ever tasted in my life.
No, they just opened their raw coconuts for us, and it was, yeah, exactly the most delicious thing. And we were like red as tomatoes, all of us.
Fun fact is, I think we got the coconut at Don Alfonso when we visited the beautiful plantation above the city of El Castillo in South Nicaragua. This long, 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 long trip. And fun fact is, actually, with the help of my fermentation guru, Soy, I actually bought his whole harvest from his plantation at the end of last year, which is going to be a new chocolate coming out from me this year, which is a direct result of the movie, actually, that we went down there. So that's
awesome. I'm so happy to hear that. That's great. And also, I remember, sorry.
Calling it Don Alfonso.
Yes. Yeah, I remember you having a great connection with him and like your comment after that you were very impressed by the quality and like how he organized everything. And
he had thought of how nature worked. And I felt that even that it was a small plantation and he could probably have made more money just planting more trees. He had a vision of how he wanted to do it. And I like that vision. So I have 250 kilo of beans waiting for me, starting roasting tests next week, actually. So that's a fun thing.
Nice. Yeah. Okay, that's one that I want to try.
Looking forward to, you know, hopefully a better year for everyone, right? Like, what is next for you guys?
We do have a few ideas. We also, when we were shooting the film, we got inspired to maybe investigate some other of our favorite foods. So yeah, so we have that in mind, but we haven't really locked down the concept yet.
Spices would do good.
Spices,
you know, spices are so, you know, like different spices parts of the world have so many spices and they're gorgeous colors and flavors.
I think it'd be so fun to shoot that film, like traveling all over and
exactly.
Yeah. Sense another collaboration cooking up here. Back to us and, you know, we'll do another panel with you. I'd absolutely love to have you guys back. This has just been such a bright spot and such a joy, you know, to see the film and to share it with our audience in the middle of, you know, what's been, you know, a pretty tough time for a lot of people. And this has just brought so much joy to so many of us. So thank you. We're really
happy. We're happy to hear. That was our idea with the film.
Yeah, that's why we wanted the film has to be more positive notes. So people, you know, it has a message, but we want to be too loud. And, you know, we just want everybody to watch the movie and enjoy it. And at at the same time go back with a little more knowledge about, you know, how things work.
Show what it takes to make a good chocolate, but also and show the pretty side, show the tough side, but also leave on a positive note and make people appreciate it more.
Cool. Well, thank you all. This is such an honor to have the world premiere. I can't even believe it.
Thank
you. And we wish you the best of luck during the pandemic. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It was wonderful.